following interview was conducted with Sally Elliot for the Purdue University Library's Oral History Program. It took place on Monday, December the 4th, at their home in West Lafayette. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Oral History Library. Welcome. Can you tell us a little bit about your born early life and your siblings, education, some things like that?
Surely. I was born in Indianapolis at Methodist Hospital, but I grew up in a little town, Maywood, Indiana, which is now part of the city. Spent a wonderful childhood there. I had a brother 12 years older than I am. My mother and father were both from Indiana, one from the southern part of the state, and one from, both were really from the southern part of the state. Went to grade school there, and then I went to Ben Davis High School. After I left Ben Davis, I had acquired an interest in physical education primarily, and went to Indiana University. But the first 2 years, I went to a school called the Normal College of the American Gymnastics Union, which is one of the oldest physical education training schools in the country, next to Sargent School of Boston. Had a very good background in all phases of athletics. Then I went to IU my junior and senior year. Enjoyed it all. Went on and got a master's degree at Indiana University. Graduated in 1957 with that. That's pretty much my formal education.
What did you major? What was your major in college?
My major was health education and physical education. Health and physical education.
And when you were in high school, were you in any particular clubs and organizations? Did you
Well, of course, we had GAA, which
pretty
was
accurate.
A forerunner to, you know, what we're what they're doing now. Well, I was in the Key Club and Spanish Club.
When you were at IU, did you lived on campus then?
What
was
the campus? I did.
And what was the campus like? And were there any professors that you recall and made an impact on you or keep in touch?
At least, a couple of. Probably the one professor that made an impact on my life was the woman who was director of the Normal College. Her name was Clara Hester. She kind of expected perfection and really demanded quite a bit from her students, and I think I learned a lot from her. And at IU, Cecilia Hendricks was a professor that I had. I took some drama courses and English courses. I had a minor in English there. She was just a wonderful person, and I learned a great deal from her outside the classroom. She was a friend, and she happened to be John DeCamp's mother-in-law, which came about, you know, later. I knew about that after I came to Purdue and worked jointly with John in promotions.
Okay. Were there any particular clubs or organizations that, when you were at IU, that you participated in, you joined, or had any offices or anything like that?
Not really.
What was the campus like?
I think it's pretty much like it is today, except it's just larger today. Most of the sororities and fraternities are still where they were when I was there. I'm sure they've added some since then. It was a pleasant place to be.
Did you join a sorority? Do you remember?
Actually, I did not, but I am an Alpha Phi, and I became an Alpha Phi when I was working at Purdue back in 1958. They were going to colonize a sorority here. They needed women of faculty to sort of be, you know, hands-on with the sorority. So I was initiated into the Alpha Phi sorority, which I enjoyed very much.
Good, very nice.
Al Stewart's wife was the president of this alumni group that we had.
Have you kept active in the alumni at IU? Do you over time, or?
Well, I'm a lifetime member of the Alumni Association at IU.
So you keep active then.
Right. But I'm afraid my allegiance is to Purdue University, having worked for them for a long time.
That following college, what was your career path? college?
Well, after leaving IU, my first job was at the YWCA in Indianapolis, and I was an assistant director and sort of in charge of programming. Did that probably for about 2.5 years, and then had an opportunity to start teaching, which is what I really wanted to do. There wasn't, at the time I had applied, there weren't any jobs, but then the Indianapolis Public School was, they were kind enough to give me a position back in 55. I worked at the YWCA from 54 through 55 and started teaching in the Indianapolis Public Schools at an elementary school, and was there through 55 and then, I'm sorry, through 58, and then just taught physical education K through 12, arranged the schedule of classes, assisted with the development of the annual district and regional city track meets, taught high school physical education and language arts, choreographed the musical dedication of the school, and was designated as a master teacher by the school system in 1958. That's pretty much what I did in Indianapolis, and then I left and came to Purdue.
Okay. That brings, I was going to turn our association to Purdue in connection with, you were named Director of Public Relations and Promotions for Women's Athletics in 75. It was about the time that, is that the time Carol Mertler came?
Yes.
So that's
before that, I don't know if you're interested in.
Oh yes, please
before
do.
That.
Yeah, right.
But I came here and was an instructor in physical education from 58 until 1967.
You mean here at Purdue?
Here at Purdue, and taught physical education and primarily health education, which was my major. And I did this in the women's physical education program, and in conjunction with my job later at the recreational gymnasium. I was coordinator of women's athletics at the rec gym. Started a guys and dolls program for the girls and guys, you know, to participate in different aspects of sports. And I did that until 1967, and I left and went to the West Lafayette Community School System and wrote a health education curriculum, taught physical education and health. Did all the usual things you do with the job, coached the cheerleading squad, and a lot of the girls started asking me why they couldn't have an athletic program, and I said, I don't know, let me find out, and the principal and the superintendent were very, very supportive, so I started a girls' athletic program there, and was the girls' sports director until 1975, and at that time, women's athletics was beginning to come to the forefront after Title IX, and it had impacted not only the schools, the high schools. I was very fortunate to coach the girls' track team there. We won two state championships, were runners up twice. I ran the state track meet for a year. But then George King was a friend of mine who was the athletic director at the time, and he asked me if I'd be interested in coming to Purdue as the women's athletic director, and I said, I don't know. Well, he said he had really two positions he needed to fill, the athletic director and also director of promotions of public relations, which I felt might be a better fit for me since, you know, I was married and I knew the other job might require maybe more travel than I was interested in doing. So I was appointed Director of Women's Athletic Promotions and Public Relations in 1975, and Carol Mertler came on board as Coordinator of Women's Activities at the same time. So we worked pretty much hand in hand in those early years.
What sort of things did you get, involved in and get the promotion program up and running?
Actually, I initiated the women's division of fundraising.
I was going to ask you about that.
We thought at that time, it was better to have a separate organization. I learned later on it was better to merge with the John Purdue Club, but we did have an organization called the Sportswomen's Society.
I was going to ask about that.
Right. And just kind of expanded it all into a really full-blown fundraising organization. And I had to start somewhere, and I didn't really know exactly how to begin. But I started by getting about 10 or 12 of my really good friends in the community to serve on a board. We called it the Purdue Sportsman Board. And they were great in helping give us community, I guess, identification. And many of those women were already members of the John Purdue Club through their husbands. We did, some usual things when you start out. We had a couple of fashion shows. We had some different types of fundraisers.
Right.
And then eventually we started the Schliemann Hubby. We called it the Jubilee in those days. And we had a big dinner at the Lafayette Country Club. This was an annual event. And we did that until my retirement.
You retired from Purdue? When did you retire?
I retired in 1988.
Oh, did you? Okay. Is that sports still going?
No. Well, Purdue Sports was happening. When I left, was going to retire, George King said, well, is there anyone here or what do you think should happen with this? And who do you think should take this over? And I said, well, you only have one woman on board that should take it over, and that's Nancy Cross. As far as the Sportsman Society, I think it should be merged with the John Purdue Club. Therefore, you don't duplicate many of the things and, let the people that are members become a member of the John Purdue Club if they're not already associated with it. So that's sort of how, there is no Sportsman Society as such anymore.
Right. Well, now, that was to raise funds for the school's athletic program. Is that correct?
Correct.
Is that what you were going to do? Okay. Scholarships and things like
right,
that.
Right, and so. That's what we did.
Uh-huh. So these are changes that occurred as a result of Title IX, that the women's program really took off.
Right. We had the Sportswomen Society all that time, but when I left, then it was merged, and so there was just one fundraising organization, and Nancy headed the entire, whole thing at that point.
There was something else that I came across, the Women's Intercollegiate Sports Organization. That was in the Division of Recreational Sports, and I guess it's now, I don't know whether part doesn't exist or if it's been merged in with the all athletic department.
All athletic department, but it was a forerunner for women's athletics, and they had a lot of, even before I became the women's coordinator at the rec gym, they had a lot of extramural clubs, they call them, and they participated probably on play days, on weekends with other schools.
Mm-hmm.
So it wasn't really a full-blown intercollegiate athletic program, but there was some competition beyond the intramurals.
Right.
That
what were some of the things that, the programs that you ran at the co-rec? I mean, were these you got some new ones going? Because you were pretty involved in that.
Right.
You could elaborate a little bit on
that. I developed that one program called Guys and Dolls, and that was a co-educational program.
Sure.
I did a lot of hiring of students to man the different sports that we had, the rifle range, the archery range. You had to have people on board. Hired the swimming instructors and people that checked members in the door. I really enjoyed
it. Kind of an active, and pretty well involved with the university, too. So
yeah,
you got a lot of
contact. I enjoyed it very much, and we ran a lot of intramural programs and had to do the drawings on who competed with whom. And, so it was a very big program, and I assume they still have an intramural program. I know I'm familiar with the fraternity over there, and they still participate.
Sure, I think they probably do. And it's, of course, they've expanded on the things that they have in co-ed, activity-wise as well as facility.
Right.
Did they have any fitness things going on at that
time? Yes, I taught a fitness program.
Oh, okay.
And I started another group, it was called Staff Wives, and I had an interesting day a week. They'd come over. morning and participate in, you know, I guess an exercise program, we call it. And then we did some aquatics in the water. And we even, you know, did some beginning golf, beginning tennis with them. It was fun. I think they had a good time.
Yeah, that's right.
I enjoyed it.
And you knew some people in the community, too,
right.
So kind of, you know, made it sort of nice. But,
right.
Yeah. But sir, Tyler and I really did make, certainly, and President Hansen made some changes, too, on the intercollegiate, didn't he, when he was here? Intercollegiate activities and sort of building up about the time that you were involved in the promotion.
Yes. Of course, when I came on board at Purdue, Fred Hubney was president.
Uh-huh.
And then when Arthur came, I think he's the one that really got most of it started as far as having the university support women's athletics. You know, they weren't really too interested in doing that, but they had to do it, like, you know, all institutions.
Well, how did they started with some and then they've expanded? Is that, I mean, so how did
Well, when we first started athletics at Purdue,
uh-huh.
I believe we had 7 sports.
For women, okay.
Just for women. Uh-huh. You know, but there were the golf and tennis and swimming, basketball, volleyball, and track and field. And cross country was part of that.
Mm-hmm.
Field hockey was also a sport. I don't know how many I named there, but
sure.
Some were 7, 8, or 9 sports.
But they competed with other schools,
yes.
Did they?
Okay. Yes. When I, as a matter of fact, Carol Mertler and I laughed, so when we, that first year, there were a lot of little schools that these intramural clubs, these extramural clubs had been competing against, and I remember we had no idea where they were, and we got the college blue book out to find out what the address was, so we'd know how to get there.
Let alone their name,
right?
But you were able to track them.
We did.
Yeah.
And we
that
got,
was a big challenge.
It was.
Yeah.
Huge challenge.
I imagine, and looking back on when you first got started, you said, boy, we got to get this thing up and running, and that really was a big thing. You really had to dig in. Of course, you had some experience before.
And that was Carol's charge. You know, she had to make the schedules. That was part of her responsibility.
Yeah.
But she said to me, you know where so-and-so is? Well, she was from Ohio, and she didn't know a lot of the schools in Indiana.
Unfortunately, you did.
So I did, so we worked that out. Okay.
That's good. I don't think they have field hockey anymore, do they?
They do not.
Yeah.
No, that was...
But the other ones that you mentioned, I think they do. And, of course, they have soccer. We didn't have soccer.
And they have softball.
They have softball. Those have been add-ons, I think.
That's true.
That looking back on the time that I've been, they have both the boys, men and women, so... I read an article that Joni Comstock said that women's participation is an important part of the improvement. She's talking about, you know, the women's program. Do you want to comment on that, or did you know Joni Comstock?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Joni came after I left, but we did become very good friends, and I was on several volunteer committees that she had.
Sure. She's in Nashville, I think.
Not anymore.
Oh.
She's assistant director of the NCAA. Indianapolis.
Oh. So you keep in touch?
Yes.
Yes. That's nice.
Okay.
And then Carol Dewey, she was a former volleyball coach, and she said community is the key for the program. And she's referring to the women's athletic program. You probably knew her, too.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Very well.
Yeah. Is she still around, or?
She's retired. I think she's living in Indianapolis. I saw her when she went into the Purdue Athletic Hall of Fame. That's the last time I've seen Carol, but you know, I have no idea right
sure.
now what she's doing.
Another thing I came across is there was a National Girls and Women's Sports Day, which was in 2002. How did that come about, and do they still have that? I guess it was at Purdue, or in 2002, a National Girl and Women's Sports Day.
Well,
I'm not sure what it was. A little hazy in the article that I had seen.
It could have been. Through the physical education program.
That they may have had some sort of an event that had to do with that, because they seem to have quite a few of these athletic events and special things.
Uh-huh. Well, I'm not really, I'm at a loss to tell you what that
was. But they may have been a national thing. now they're talking about graduation rates, and is that, how has that changed over time?
Well, I think we always had very high graduation rates among the women and very high academics, which was one thing that, you know, kind of prided, we had a lot of pride in that, and I always talked to that point, you know, how the women's athletes were good students, and one thing we didn't have to worry about trying to get into class, they would go to class.
How, were you ever involved in, or touch base on, as far as recruiting of any of the athletes that you get to know when they come on campus for visits or?
Well, interestingly so, Sharon Verso, who's now our women's basketball coach, when she came to campus, you know, I met with her and talked with her, and then subsequently when she decided to come to Purdue and was Miss Basketball, State of Indiana, I remember bringing her in here, and we couldn't put a Purdue uniform on her, but I told her to bring her basketball uniform from the state, and we perched her on the Boilermaker Special. We took a lot of promotional pictures and, you know, wrote a lot of things about her.
Oh.
And I had the opportunity to write for, actually, the football program that went out every week, and I had a series of articles in every one of those. John DeCamp had me write those, and I wrote about each of the sports for women.
Is this a football program that if they have had games, or what football program are you referring to?
The football program, yes.
Oh.
The printed program.
Okay.
That
okay.
They
have.
Yes.
So you really had a lot, and you did, then you knew Johnny DeCamp, who you said earlier.
Very well.
Yes.
I knew Johnny before, but when I actually shared an office with John, after when I first went there, my office was in Mackey Arena, and Carol Mertler's office was in Lambert Fieldhouse. John and I were roommates, so to speak.
Office mates, or
yeah.
Whatever.
He was very, very generous in teaching me a lot, interviewing and writing. And writing was my second love, so that came easy for me. But he really was helpful in a lot of. I always respect him for that, for helping.
On this, on your sports, as you look back, what was some of the most challenging things that you faced when you were involved in the women's athletics program?
Well, I suppose in the beginning, the most challenging was trying to sell, and I use this term lovingly, good old boys, the fact that, you know, we weren't going to destroy the program, because the feeling was, you know, we were going to ruin the program that they worked for, particularly the John Purdue men. And I guess I had developed over the years a philosophy that, and I tried to relate this to the men that I came in contact with, that for every privilege that you're given, there's a responsibility, and that hopefully things will get better. I think every time you're given a right, it's your duty to do a good job. And also try to tell them that my philosophy is for every tomorrow there was a yesterday, so you have to face the future and the present on perhaps what happened, but don't dwell in it, but take the good things from that and try to go forward. And I try to let them know that, you know, we weren't going to do anything that would hurt the men's program. We just wanted to have our own opportunity. We felt we deserved a chance, just like the men's minor sports, so to speak, that they had at Purdue. You know, those we weren't generating any revenue, just beginning to generate revenue in basketball.
That's a challenge.
Right, and you know, George King, God love him, he was given this charge by the university, so he tried to get, I think, the people in the positions that would maybe do a positive job, and we always tried to really accentuate the positive aspect of it, which was giving women an opportunity to participate. Some schools, I think, started many, you know, they had many sports. more than
any, yeah, right.
8 or 9, and I think that took a drain on the budget. And I kept asking Buford buyers every year, I say, what's my budget? He said, well, we don't really know. You just do what you need to do, and, you know, don't get crazy with what you spend, and then we'll look at it at the end of the year, and we'll tell you if you spent too much or you still have room to grow. So I was always permitted to pretty much do what I wanted to do within reason.
Yeah.
I'm sure there was a budget for, you know, how much they could spend on recruiting. And they gave them a number of scholarships, and many of the coaches split those scholarships and maybe would give half scholarships to maybe two women instead of one full ride in the beginning.
Uh-huh. That was a real challenge. And then, of course, trying to get the people within the state to, you know, get, as the program gets up and running, is to get the people to come too as well. So it's a combination, isn't it? A big it's part of the challenge.
I remember the first women's basketball game we had, I thought, well, I can get all these programs ready and get the people there to get the people in and have the programs for sale. And I think, you know, we had about 300 people, maybe.
This isn't Mackie, right?
Mackie, yeah. It's okay.
My response to that sometimes is, you know, I do a class for 1 or 1,000 or 100, doesn't make any difference. We go with it.
Yeah,
anyway.
And yeah. You try to do a good job. You know, I think everybody that was associated with the program did a good job. As I say, George was very good in letting me try different approaches.
Well, he respected you. You had a lot of experience in coming here. You knew people.
I remember one time I went in and I said, would it be all right? And he said, look, he said, you run the program. And if I don't think you did something right, I'll let you know.
Right, okay. What has been your activity since you left Purdue? What have you been doing? What kinds of things? And how did you happen to decide to leave?
Well, I decided to leave primarily because my husband, Bill Combs, who was team physician and director of the hospital at that time for 40 years, decided to retire. And I thought, well, probably I should retire as well. I was only 55 at the time, and it was probably a little bit too soon, but just kind of played for a couple of years and then decided I needed to do something, and George said, well, we could probably find something for you to do around here, but I didn't really want to do that, so I became a realtor and then a broker, and I spent 10 years selling real estate in Lafayette for F.C. Tucker.
Okay.
And
but you kept in touch with the athletics.
Oh, yes, you know.
Well, golf must be one of your specialties because now all of a sudden you're the local one head, right?
Well, I was president-elect last year for our Greater Lafayette Women's Golf Tournament.
Sure.
And I will be president this year.
Okay.
I play a lot of golf and belong to a couple of leagues here in Lafayette and one in Naples, Florida, where I live. I'd have to say golf is my love, but I'd say the thing that has always been most important to me and probably has kept me active and younger are my friends. And I think to have friends, you have to be a friend, and I try to be a good friend, and I have two really special groups of friends. One of them's contemporaries of mine and a bit older, and another group that are my younger golfing friends.
Sounds like a good match.
Yes.
That sounds good. A couple things. You know, the transcript's going to be turned over to the archives. Any comment on preservation or archival that you'd like to share? Value of preservation?
I just think it's very important, you know, to know maybe what went on before and how the history of certain areas have developed. And, there are always people that need to do research, and they're always going to be training women in physical education and athletic training and business management and athletic trainers. I'm sure a lot of the assignments are to do research and find out what happened back then, what was treated. But I will say one thing that I think they'll find is Purdue really didn't duplicate any of their services. When women came on board, sports information took care of women just like the men, the trainers, the medical staff. You know, there weren't separate this and separate that. And
it was integrated.
Right. We had to have a little division in the beginning to really get recognition, get it going. But Purdue did it the right way, and I think history will prove that to be a really good thing, rather than having two departments. Now, Iowa, for instance, had two athletic departments, women's athletic department and a men's. And, you know, to me,
that's a waste of money. Yeah, that's a challenge. That's right. How about an outstanding event in your life? What would you classify that? Think about that for a minute. And while you're thinking about that, I'm interested in what are your longest memories of Purdue?
Well, I suppose the most outstanding event in my life was marrying Bill Combs and inheriting two wonderful children from him. I really never have had any children of my own, but I consider his children my children, and particularly his son, who was 10 years old when I married him. And we've just always been very close. And then had the privilege of marrying Edward Elliot. I've had a lot of fun with both of them, both good Purdue men. I've just been so blessed. I've had a very full life, and I hope it continues that way. And to just pick out one special event, perhaps one of them was when I was a recipient of the Black Coat Award at Purdue for promotion of women's athletics. That was fun.
Did you get any other? Were there any other awards that you got? What was the nature of that particular one that you got that you just mentioned? I'm not familiar with the title.
It was for outstanding contribution to women's athletics.
Oh, I'm not familiar with that one.
It's given each year at the Schliemann Hefty. And I'm glad to see that they're continuing the Schliemann Hefty.
Yes.
I guess I was inducted into the women's athletic, into the AAUW. I was the outstanding woman in sports in 1976, and that was kind of a highlight for me.
Did that come as a surprise to you?
I was totally surprised. Yeah.
How did you find out?
Well, I went to the dinner, and
the dinner was here, or
it was at. Yes, it was here. Uh-huh. And Carol Cars was a good friend of mine. She was a women's athletic director at the University of Illinois. And George King was there. And I thought, well, isn't this interesting, you know? Then I started putting two and two together while I was having dinner and thought perhaps it might be me.
Was the purpose of the dinner some sort of an award for something, or was just a dinner that you got?
No, it's an annual dinner.
Oh. Is this for the Schliemann?
No, it's for people in the Lafayette community.
Oh, okay.
They give...
What's the nature? Who hosts the dinner? What's the name of the dinner?
It's now given probably... I'm ashamed to tell you, I'm not sure, but... I'll find out. I'll research that. But it's sort of a big deal. You know, they always have a good speaker. And
it's been going on.
Is it at Purdue?
No, it's a community event.
Oh, okay.
It's a Greater Lafayette community event.
Okay.
You know, they give an outstanding homemaker, woman in sports.
Oh, the Purdue women, I think I recognize that. There have been...
I have the plaque downstairs. I guess I could go get it.
That's okay. They give it once a year, and they have different categories.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Right.
Uh-huh. And the categories have changed somewhat over
the
years.
That's right.
But,
I think they now give somebody in high school also gets one, and there's some sort of category. I think I know.
Right.
And that started about in the 70s or something.
Yes, it did. I think I might have been second or third recipient of
it. Yeah. That's very nice. I know you've got a lot of materials there. Anything special that you'd like to feature about the sports and things? Because you were pretty close to it for a number of years and really got in on the early early time. Any comments on that that we could fill in that researchers might benefit by? Maybe how it's changed?
It's changed because it's totally funded today. And it wasn't,
well,
you know.
Well, that's a big change. Mm-hmm. You know.
It's a huge change.
And that takes a lot of time to get that up and running.
Right. I have to say Purdue has just done a marvelous job. I think we've had outstanding presidents that have believed in women. And it probably started before they ever thought women were going to be in athletics. But by bringing, you know, outstanding women on staff and on the faculty, people that believe in what they're doing and, you know, want to have a sense of purpose about their life. And I hope history will prove maybe I had a little contribution to make to women's athletics.
Is there any comment or something that you'd like to make that maybe I've forgotten about or that you'd like to make some review?
Well, I guess the one thing that I remember when I was in college, I was asked to write my philosophy of education. And I really, frankly, had no idea what my philosophy was. But I think I could write one today.
Okay,
in that, you know, my chin, you'll cut this out. Just that, well, I guess I would have to say when this was probably for a course I was taking or something, and I think today I'd have to say that the education that I had served me well and has enabled me to really pursue a lot of interesting endeavors. I've done a lot of different things, and probably beyond the basics of learning to read and write, my education prepared me, my physical education background prepared me to have all the experiences that I've cherished over the years. I think education's ever changing. I don't think it's ever a stagnant thing. And education today has so much to offer anyone that wants to pursue a higher degree. And I think there's so many opportunities for maybe people that perhaps don't want to pursue a college education, but technology, they can go to two-year colleges, community colleges, and I think that's important in every community. And
about your interaction with the students, have you been teaching? Any comment on that, your interaction with students? That's key to education, the students.
Well, I just loved teaching. I really did, and the students. I still hear from many of the women that I taught at West Lafayette High School. That was a really great time in my life. And I thought, I have to get the best girls in this high school to get in this program so everybody will want to do it. And you know what's happened to high school athletics. And it's just a matter of evolution. I think that's why we have better athletes, of course, at college level now, because they're getting better training in their secondary education, and they're even starting now very young. You know, there's some junior high certainly, and opportunities for girls to go to camp, and you know, when they're in the fourth grade, they can start going to camp, the Purdue camp.
See, there's a big change that's taking place.
It has.
You're addressing that.
It has. And I think, I guess maybe the best teacher, I think, creates an atmosphere for learning. And whether it's teaching per se or maybe serving as a role model, I think you have to enable people to learn and to experience an activity such as our women are doing today in athletics. I don't think it's everything, because not everybody wants to be an athlete, nor do they have the skill to be it. But I think a lot of women of my generation enjoy watching younger women and participate. I think they watch them on TV and go to the games. I believe the crowd at women's athletic, the women's basketball especially, is a very gray crowd. I don't think it's young people. I think it's people that maybe were deprived the opportunity to do that, so they're living vicariously through these women.
Could be. Any other comments? Anything that I mentioned that you'd like to refer to or your notes there?
Well, no, not really. I just have I still have something I want to do very badly, and that's do some writing about women's athletics. Not necessarily who won and who lost, but how great it is to be able to have an opportunity to participate. And I have an outline, and I've talked to your boss, Mullen?
Oh, Dean Mullen.
Dean Mullen.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and he said we have, and his wife, of course, is interested in women's studies. So maybe I'll have an opportunity to pursue that, or maybe I can help teach as a volunteer, help teach a course or something someday when I'm here.
That's good.
Anything? Right now, I'm having fun, though. I'm on the board, the foundation board of Morin's Park, and that's where I live, in Naples. I'm on the board of directors.
And what does that involve?
Well, I'm basically on the support committee of that organization, but we have monthly meetings. The board has monthly meetings. And right now, I'm editing a cookbook. I've acquired recipes from over 83 women that live at Morin's Park. And these recipes are hors d'oeuvre recipes and appetizers to everybody. We go to dine between 6:30 and 7. The dining room closes. You have to be seated by a certain time. But people are very social down there. And they, you have someone in, maybe four or six people, and then you walk to the dining room. And so when they come in for their cocktail, you like to have a little hors d'oeuvre or something. So that's what this is going to be all about. And the date for publishing that is going to be in March, and it's going to be ready for our annual meeting at Morin's Park. So that's what I'm doing now. So I try to keep busy. Between that and golf and looking after Ed, I have a very full life.
That's very good. We really appreciate you taking the time, and we want to thank you very much for this.
Well, I appreciate the opportunity to say what I think.
It's very good, and we really appreciate that.